Child of God, I greet you in the name of Jesus Christ. I'm Pastor Felumos, the host of Living by Grace. I believe one of the greatest gifts that the Lord has given us is the gift of grace. The grace to live the life that God gave to us for our faith in Christ Jesus. Beloved, the life that we received is a good life. It's a great life. It's a prosperous, healthy, and powerful life. But we need grace to be able to live that life in this world. I'm grateful to God that you are joining me and several members of the family of grace all over the world for today's broadcast. For I believe, God, that you will be empowered by his grace to be able to go forth and live the life of God that he has given you, that he has given me, to live in our different sphere of life. Thank you for joining me. And may the Lord bless you in Jesus' name. Amen. Welcome back. If you remember last week, we began to deal with the question, why good people do bad things? Why good people do bad things? And that's what we continue today. You know, when we take that question or that topic and we apply it in the context of faith, Christians, it will be that, why do Christians commit sin? Why do Christians act in violation of their vows to the Lord? Our text was Psalm 15 from verse 1 to 5. Psalm 15 from verse 1 to 5. And we saw there that a Christian, as described in verse 1, is a person that lives in the house of the Lord. And then from verse 2 to 5, we were told how a Christian is supposed to conduct his affairs. How a Christian is supposed to conduct himself, conduct his business with his neighbors. He's supposed to be truthful. He's supposed to speak righteously. He's supposed to act blamelessly. He's supposed to walk uprightly. He's supposed to hold in contempt the deceitful. He's supposed to not give money to his brethren, to exploit them, and so on and so forth. And then the last portion of verse 5 says, it is only the Christians that live like this that can be sure that they will not be moved. And we apply that to mean that when the trumpet shall sound, that is the Christian that will be raptured. That is the Christian that should expect the reward of righteousness from the Lord. And we gave one. We said one very obvious reason was excuses. We said brethren have this knack of using the tough times that they are going through to justify why they should go ahead and disobey God. And we establish it that, see, we do not doubt the fact that the times that we are going through is tough. But you see, disobedience to God is disobedience to God, period. And that there is no excuse, there is no toughness of times or challenging situation that can remove the fact that that which you did is a disobedience to God. And so we are reminded of the need to be mindful of every word that comes out of the mouth of God. For that is the final position of God. You should live by every word that comes out of the mouth of God, not by the bread that the society around you feeds you. Today we'll be looking at the second reason why good people do bad things. The second reason why Christians act in violation of their vows. And that second reason is ignorance. But before we go on, let's read our text again. Psalm 15, verse 1 to 5. Psalm 15, verse 1 to 5, quickly. The Lord, who shall abide in your tabernacle, and who shall dwell in your holy hill? He that walks uprightly, number one. He that walketh righteousness, number two. He that speaketh truth in his heart, number three. He that backbiteth not with his tongue, number four. He that doeth no evil to his neighbor, number 5. He that taketh up no reproach against his neighbor, number 6. In whose eyes a vile person is condemned, number 7. He that honoreth him that feareth the Lord, number 8. He that sweareth to his own oath and changeth not, number 9. He that putteth out his money without interest, number 10. And takes no reward against the innocent, number 11. He that doeth these things shall never be moved. That's our text. So why do brethren not live like this? One, because of excuses. They believe the report of the devil, the message of the devil, who tells them that, see, you are human. It's natural. You can't fight against it. You need to survive. And on the strength of that argument that is sponsored from the pit of hell, you see a child of God knowingly act in disobedience to God and make himself God in the place of God. He dethrones God in his life and makes himself God. The second reason that we want to look at today is ignorance. Another reason is ignorance. Ignorance. Hosea chapter 4 verse 6. Hosea chapter 4 verse 6 says, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Hosea chapter 4 verse 6. Then in the New Testament, Jesus said, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. Knowledge. Knowledge. The opposite of knowledge is ignorance. Somebody once said that knowledge can be defined as a knowing that gives you an edge. A knowing that gives you an edge. When a child of God lacks knowledge about the greatness of God, the faithfulness of God, then the devil has got a leeway into his life. Because if you remember in the temptation of Eve, the strategy that the devil employed to make Eve to backslide, to sin against God, was to tell Eve that God was a liar. And because Eve hasn't got the kind of knowledge about the greatness of God, the integrity of God, he believed the lie of the devil about God. And that was what made Eve to do that. When a child of God lacks knowledge about the greatness of God, lacks knowledge about the faithfulness of God to his word, lacks knowledge about the integrity of God, that he can never make a promise and not fulfill it. The devil can use your ignorance to make you feel alone and abandoned in your situation. He can use your ignorance about the omnipresence of God to make you feel as if though you are alone and God is not with you in whatever you are going through. He can use your ignorance about the omnipotence of God, the omnipotence of God, to give you the impression that you are helpless and nobody can help you. That's a lie. He has used it before against Adam and succeeded. He used it against Jesus and he failed. The Bible said when Jesus was in the wilderness and he was hungry, the devil came to him and employed the same strategy of being alone and abandoned against Jesus. He said, since there is no bread provided you, why don't you go ahead and use stones to meet your need? And Jesus said, no. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes out of the mouth of God. Jesus was trying to tell him, I know the Lord is with me in this situation. And very soon, he is going to speak and I will hear him. Beloved, you are not alone. I want you to know that. And I also want you to know that the God that is with you is able to help you. The Bible says concerning God that with God all things are possible. That God is able to do exceeding abundantly above all you can ever think or ask according to his power that is at work in you. In Luke chapter 1, Mary asked the angel when he told her that she is going to become the mother of a child. She said, how can I become a mother when I don't have a man? And the angel said unto Mary that the Spirit of God will come upon you. The power of God will rest upon you. And even though you have no man in this situation, you are going to conceive. Believe me, beloved, the Lord God Almighty that is with you is able to help you. Just hold on. Every advice that you are receiving from the enemy through the people around you to put forth your hand and do that which is unrighteous to get yourself out of this situation is not a good advice. Because if you put out your hand to lay your hands upon unrighteousness, how are you even sure that it will work for you? And by the time you put forth your hand unto unrighteousness, you do unrighteousness and it does not work for you, it becomes double jeopardy. And even if it works for you, don't forget that for every favor that the devil does for a man, down the line, he is going to require it from you. And he's going to take much more than that favor. Because the Bible says it is only God whose blessings maketh rich without hardening sorrow. Meaning, if you follow the counsel of the devil to help yourself, sorrow is bound to follow it. For it is the blessing of the Lord that maketh rich without hardening sorrow, beloved. I don't want you to be ignorant. I don't want you to be uninformed. The Bible says we should not give the devil as little as a foothold in our lives. So even in the little things that you need to take decisions, wait upon the Lord. See, the sinfulness of our choices is not in whether we got result or not. It is in whether we acted in obedience to the word of God or not. So I need you to know all this about God. In Joshua chapter 1, the Lord said to Joshua, I will never leave you nor forsake you. As I was with Moses, so I will be with you. He's saying the same thing to you this morning, beloved. Don't be ignorant of God's presence with you in that tough time. Let me give you one more example. The disciples left without Jesus in obedience to him and they ran into his storm. And they thought they were alone and were going to die. And in the midst of that storm, Jesus showed up because he was never really far from them. Believe me, beloved, the Lord is with you. Hold your peace, be still, be calm, and you will hear the counsel of the Lord. So you need to know this about God. Then another knowledge you need to have about yourself. You should not be ignorant about God, one. Then you should not be ignorant about who you are in Christ. Beloved, I need you to know that you are a spirit that lives in a body. You are a spirit. You have a spiritual life. This physical world is not your life. It's an expression of your life. So you should understand that you do not fight the challenges of your life carnally. 2 Corinthians chapter 10 verse 3 says, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. They are mighty through God for the pulling down of strongholds. See, beloved, beyond the physical crisis you are seeing, there is a spiritual undertone. You need to fight the battles of life spiritually because you are a spirit. You need to know that you are a spirit being. And so turn to God. Go spiritual. Use the blood of Jesus. Use the word of God. The Bible says we overcome in life by the blood of Jesus and the word of our testimony. So child of God, two reasons why Christians go ahead and do wrong things. One, because of excuses, and two, because of ignorance. Ignorance about God and His presence in their life, and ignorance about themselves, that they are spirit beings. I want to believe that this short exhortation has opened your eyes, and you will go forth from here, waging the war, fighting the battle of the spirit, as to have a life that is in conformity to the word of God. Remember, brethren, we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers. Thank you for listening. Until I see you next week, keep living under the atmosphere of grace. Remember, the life that you are given is a good life. There are forces that do not want you to enjoy it, and you overcome them by the blood of the Lamb and the word of your testimony. God bless you. Let's have a word of prayer. Father, we thank you for bringing to an end the series you started with us last week about why good people do bad things. We have learned. We receive the grace to live according to the life you've given us. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name we have prayed. Amen. Look at the screen. You will see our info. You can always get across to us. God bless you. Till I see you again. Amen.